Electronic arts are not deemed to be as important as, if you like, high culture. The Royal Opera House gets 20 million or whatever it is every year. Nightlife, music, effectively it gets no support at all.
Absolutely none. If you look at the impact it's had on society, culture, if you look, the inspiration it's given to people to go into a multitude of other creative areas, all we get is obstructions and obstacles. If you compare that to the Opera House, they get £80 million to build it, and they get £25 million a year of your money to put on whatever they want to do. Not a penny. If you look at what it's actually generated, tourism, for example, how many people do you think come to London to go out to the multitude of warehouse events and Ministry of Fabric, God knows how many other clubs, and how many people come to the Opera House? What does it do to tourism? Why do they get 25 million quid? I think because we're seen in some way as being delinquent or reprobate, even though the rest of society has hijacked almost everything we've done musically. The whole thing's ubiquitous now, but we are still seen as a degenerate subculture, and it's purely because of narcotic element. And the strangest thing as well, I've been listening to people moan about oppressive drug laws for years, and they don't actually need to be here. These laws are placed upon you with your acquiescence. If everybody said, fuck off, I'm not listening to you anymore, 5 million people smoking cannabis, you're all going to light up, you're going to smoke, what are you going to do about it? There's nothing. You cannot police this, you cannot regulate that, you cannot enforce it upon us. But people do, we'll just, for 20, 25, 30 years, just want to moan about it all the time. And it's our acceptance of these things, which, and I'm not saying let's have a free-for-all for everything, but, they are not, this is not particular to our world. I mean, if you've been to any police balls, any of you, there's prisoners' balls, I mean, you see that that's a riot, mate, I'll tell you. And,
I think 15 years ago, this area we're in now, right, which is now kind of, the epicentre of all things cool, was an absolute shithole, right, that had skinheads walking around beating up Asians, right, and that was about it. I live in West London, I would never come here, there was nothing here. Curtin Road looked like kind of Belfast in the 1970s, right, and then someone opened a club called the Bass Clef, yeah, in Oxton Square, which this man ran and then suddenly someone thought, oh, we're going to open a bar then, and someone done his pub up, next to it, and then after that,
It
took quite a while, and then James and other guys, Secret Sundays, and some other parties started doing parties on a roof in Brick Lane. And I think it was 2000, I played for Secret Sundays on a roof in Brick, what's that club called? 93 Feet East. And there was about 100 people there, and we felt like we were pioneers. I felt like I was dancing in a different country. Yeah. I really did, and it was like really exciting, right? The only reason there's a Holiday Inn now, yeah, is because people like James did his parties, people come into the area and decided, we want to go club, this is where we want to go clubbing. You opened up round the corner, so, we need a hotel, right? So the multinationals come in on this, the Hackney Council, right, who have done everything they can to fuck people off, right, I've had a windfall only because of clubbing. If people hadn't built clubs and put on parties in this part of London, this part of London would be desolate still, right? And the people buying £1 million flats wouldn't be, no, and it would just be full of, like it was before, a few people doing some nice art and nice cheap rents like they've got in Berlin. And it's about time that the councils in London realise what a bonus and what a plus thing club culture is.
I mean, in regeneration terms, I can show you photographs of of Cowcross Street and all the surrounding areas of
around the fabric.
There is not one outlet or shop that is the same now. There are now coffee shops and food. before, it was absolutely nothing. It was, that's why I went there, because there was nothing there, and all there was a few scary blood-stained butchers wandering around the place with cleavers and hooks, and I knew they'll sod off soon. That's why we went there, and it's completely changed. And everyone does anything. If you look, you know, the effect that things like Blue Note had on this area and everything, it's all of a sudden, it puts things on the map, and people start going there, and then that is the seed and the sort of flashpoint for those regeneration programs.
Well, that's good, because I was just going to ask you, which direction is London nightlife going to go into next? Obviously, this area became a real hub 10 years ago. 5 years ago, it sort of shifted up Kingston Road to Dalston, which is now trendier than the plague. And, you know, but Hackney have now called time on Dalston. They said, look, there's enough licences being given out. Where do you think nightlife is going to go next?
It'll go south. It's already happened in Brixton.
Yeah.
And it's already happening in
Peckham. Hasn't it been south for a long time? We've all been going to
not really. Not on a scale that Hoxton and Shoreditch, Haggerston has taken off. I came here just outside of this building, less than 10 metres outside that front door. I ran a club. In a little jazz club, when this whole area was desolate. And I went in there in the summer of 1988, and I left in the summer of 1995. And by that time, the area had begun to grow. New clubs, new bars had sprung up. The art community realized this was a fantastic place to rent studios and squat studios. It was a brilliant place, and as Terry rightly said, Hackney Council were very obstructive in the beginning, wouldn't grant licences for anything here, and now it's fallen into their lap, so to speak, and they still don't want it. So other areas of London which are undergoing regeneration, south of the river, like Brixton, Peckham, in the next 3 or 4 years, the trendsetters, the opinion formers, the fashionistas, that's where they will go. And the vanguard of them have already gone there. So who knows, maybe that will be the future of London clubbing. But everything is cyclical, because before it happened east, everything was happening west, where I come from. I've been a mainstay player at the Notting Hill Carnival for over 30 odd years. And long before London club culture took off properly, Carnival was always going on. And it was always a showcase and a platform for the newest forms of electronic music, if you want to call it that. Pirate radio, fanzines, all of these things had a platform at the Notting Hill Carnival. Long before the style magazines had begun, and all the peripheral things that go around making a scene. So, yes, first it was west, now it's east, and I put my money on in the next 3 or 4 years, everything will go south.
So do you think Peckham?
Yeah, I mean, you know, we're originally from East London, from Brick Lane, and at least half the events we do here now are not in East London, they're in South London, because of people's, whether that's residents, authorities are just a lot more relaxed still down there, you know, like we can still do a roof party in Peckham, pay under people and not get shut down.
Right.
Like, wouldn't that be undreamable of now, anywhere around here, get shut down in a second?
Yeah, property prices, the reason where, you know, long before Fabric and I was doing warehouse passes, they'd be over in Hackney or Baylor Street and things like that, because it was derelict and it was cheap.
Yeah.
I could go and put a warehouse party on in Chelsea or the West End, and so as these, you know, you try and get anything around here now. So as these things develop, we regenerate, renew things, and it becomes very, very expensive, and so we have to go and find a new shithole to work in. And it's probably driven by purely by property prices.
I do think, though, we're running out of shitholes in London. That's the problem.
Yeah.
I played in
Yeah, they would be living in a palace then.
I played in Acne Week last week.
Yeah.
God, that's still pretty run down, especially around where I presume they moved a lot of the businesses out to build the Olympics Stadium, but never bothered kind of doing anything with the empty buildings. And get to the warehouse I was playing at, I stopped at two different places because I had no idea where it was, and there was two other warehouses. I was knocking on the door, I was just, no, wrong place. And there was kids walking around everywhere, and it was pretty cool. And that seemed to me like kind of the last outpost, really. I mean, any further east than Hackney Wick, and you're in Essex.
do you remember all the nights, I'm sure you've done it night after night, loading up the car with a load of mixtapes, getting company, and just literally going around, peering in the windows and looking at warehouses, looking, driving through industrial zones and just searching for empty derelict space?
Yeah, I mean, Dizzy Rascal, right? You know, how much money does he make for his record company and publishing house? Now, he would have never been even in existence if it weren't for a little club in Bow. Right? So if you're shutting down all these clubs and there's nowhere for the next Dizzy Rascal to be. So really, I think kind of, you know, us four talking to guys like this who are committed kind of isn't really going to do anything, but maybe, you know, if the big publishing houses and the multinational record companies actually realise that they need us to feed them stuff, you know, maybe they're the people who ought to be lobbying the councils and Boris and things like that, because, you know, once you take away the roots of anything, you know, the people at the top who are actually making all the money, you know, their money's going to dry up.
It would be almost impossible to quantify accurately, though, because, you know, the culture has leached out and transposed itself into so many areas and affected so many other things, and how you apportion that and how you sort of equate those benefits or detriments, it's almost impossible to equate it now, but it's very, very substantial.
One more question I just wanted to ask you was if there's any particular club or DJ or promoter who's coming up now that you've seen that you really felt was a good tip for the future?
In London.
In London. That you've been to?
I've got three for you. James Priestley, Terry Farley.
I think there's loads and loads of people. I mean, I think that now it's very hard, I think, because I remember we booked Derek Carter to play at a boy's own party, and he'd only been over here once before. Luke Solomon had him playing at his in Kenny Hawkes' club, Space, and they said, you've got to book him. When we booked him, and he played it, we had a substation south in Brixton, which was a little gay bar, kind of a gay cruising bar. And we had him play there. And after his set, I was playing at the Ministry, and I looked at my record box, and I was just like, I don't want to DJ anymore. I've got no records. It was like someone had punched me in the face with reality of someone's genius, right? Of Derek Carter. The problem is nowadays, you know, with technology, it's kind of not too hard to be that good at mixing, that good at everything else. So I think it's very hard for a DJ to stand out now. We'll be right back.